Welcome everyone to our next virtual series within the Division of Gynecologic Oncology. I'm Ursula Matulonis, medical oncologist within the division, and am really happy and privileged. We're happy and privileged to have Dr. Sue Campos and Rebecca Porter. Dr. Campos is our director of pathways within the Division of Gynecologic Oncology, as well as the director of educational activities within our division. Rebecca Porter is a junior faculty, but getting more so not so junior, and really has a strong interest in immunotherapy and devising new ways to treat GYN cancers via immunotherapy. So I think it's gonna be a good session tonight. You guys were kind enough to send in lots of different questions, some of which we're going to tackle, some of which were a little out of scope for this, but it's okay. We'll try to get to them, and if not, tackle them at a different webinar. So I'm going to start off the webinar by certainly introduce Drs. Campos and Porter, and then kind of start with some open-ended questions that are basic to GYN cancers and new treatments, new developments, what's happened over the past year. And then if further questions come up, Katie Poulin, my administrative assistant who organized all of this tonight, is gonna send us some questions as they come up. So, all right, so Dr. Campos, Sue, there have been quite a few questions about new therapies available right now for both ovarian cancer as well as uterine cancer. We'll talk about cervical cancer later, but now we can start on ovary and uterine cancer. And can you talk to us about what treatment advances have been made recently for ovarian cancer as well as for uterine cancer?
Sure, and that could be like an hour and a half, but we don't have that, you know? So, I mean, I think that we could certainly speak about what has been done. And I think you phrased that well, because there are some amazing drugs coming to light, and we can talk a little bit about that too. But I mean, I really think that we've been doing this for several years, and I think what's really actually changed the paradigm of how we treat patients with ovarian cancer has really been the introduction of the PARP inhibitors. And these oral drugs, you know, came to us several years ago, really with a great hypothesis as to why they would work. But over the course of more than a decade, I mean, they have really found a place in ovarian cancer. We first studied this only in patients with that had BRCA mutations. We expanded that to patients who relapsed with ovarian cancer and found that we could actually, you know, prolong progression-free survival, the time away from not having disease. And then most recently, we have found that by giving PARP inhibitors after first line therapy, after that induction therapy, that it's been really monumental in terms of how patients have done. I mean, progression-free survival has extended. Ursula was at ESMO not too long ago in Paris. We were very jealous. And, you know, she was there to see the overall survival, 7-year overall survival data with the use of olaparib in patients with BRCA mutations. And when you look at these curves in terms of how long people are living with, you know, advanced ovarian cancer, it is actually dumbfounding. It's just amazing the success that these PARP inhibitors have brought to the table. Now, you know, over the years, you know, you have these drugs, you use these drugs, and then you start asking different questions in terms of how do we combine these PARP inhibitors with other agents so that they actually have more efficacy? What happens if individuals stop responding? How do you combine them with other agents or other agents out there that might actually have efficacy in ovarian cancer? So I think if this was a multiple choice test and we had to pick a drug or group of drugs, I think the PARP inhibitors have really changed the way we do things. And I think that more drugs that are coming are completely different drugs. And, you know, there is a trial called Soraya trial that is looking at molecule called, it's an antibody drug conjugate, and that targets the folate receptor, specifically targets the folate receptor and delivers an old drug to the cancer cell. That has actually been quite successful, and hopefully we'll hear a little bit more about that. So there continues to be new and novel drugs explored in ovarian cancer. And, you know, some of us who've been around for a long time have really had the luxury of seeing how this changes people's lives. And it's quite inviting. in terms of uterine cancer, again, it's been, you know, I just got off a call. We were talking about uterine cancer and immunotherapy. Immunotherapy has changed uterine cancer. We now think of two groups of patients, those patients that have this entity called they're deficient in MMR or proficient. And now we have drugs, you know, pembrolizumab. We have a drug called dostarlimab in patients that are deficient in MMR. And yet we have these amazing trials done by some of our colleagues in New York and with some of our trials being done here, looking at a combination of immunotherapy and other groups of drugs like VEGF inhibitors. One of those such drugs is called lenvatinib, who also has pretty significant activity in patients with uterine cancer that that are MMR proficient. And then there's a whole group of other drugs looking at hormonal therapies, hormonal therapy combinations. So, you know, uterine cancer used to be, I hate to say, you know, not so well developed over the course of the years. And now it's just really boomed in terms of people's interest in early stage uterine cancer, the molecular genetics that makes up uterine cancer, and some of the novel therapies that exist. A little
long-winded,
yeah. I'm sorry.
No. There's, you're right. We could talk about this for a while. So as questions come in, I'm gonna bring them up. I don't know if you guys, Rebecca and Sue, can see the questions, but so a couple of other comments, Sue, about other new. So I agree. So like in ovarian cancer, I think we've made some headway with PARP inhibitors. For sure. And I think, you know, the prevalence, meaning the number of women who are surviving ovarian cancer and living with this is continues to increase significantly in the United States. There have been, I know this came out in I think SGO news this morning, and I agree. And I think we've all been tracking this. And Rebecca, I want you to also chime in. I'll let Sue start, but you know that the news about how the different companies, so obviously olaparib, rucaparib, and niraparib, are starting to withdraw the FDA indications for women with who are more heavily pretreated, specifically those with underlying BRCA mutations, and obviously this is coming from some data. Specifically, I think the trial that we know about the most is ARIEL-4, which was presented at ESMO, showing the results in BRCA-mutated women who are either getting rucaparib versus chemotherapy. The NOVA data, perhaps suggesting, and the NOVA is complicated, and again, we could spend a lot of time on this. And then SOLO-3, which is going to be also presented at IGCS and at end of this week. Comments, Sue, about how these have changed your practice or not changed your practice?
Right. So, you know, this information came to us in the form of a dear doctor's letter. And, you know, we looked at we really got a couple of sentences in terms of something called a hazard ratio. And I think that we all looked at that and we were a little bit baffled by it. But at the end of the day, I think I speak for myself, but I think others share this opinion, is all really want to see the data that actually, you know, ended up showing a detrimental benefit at that stage. What I think is very important to actually recognize is that the data in these individuals that were out 3 to 4 prior lines of therapy should not be misconstrued in terms of the benefit that these drugs have very early on. You know, when you take a look at some of this data in late lines, I should say, okay, these individuals could have been treated very heavily. They also, you know, could have developed some resistance to some of these medications. The truth be told is that we would have not known that at that point in time. And also, the studies are actually quite complex. So in the context of some of those studies are patients who are still platinum sensitive and patients who are platinum resistant. So we have this blurb saying that the confidence interval, the hazard ratio is greater than 1, which suggests a detrimental benefit. But we really have to go back and literally look at that data and dissect it. And that's what we're all looking to see, is that data. What in that body of data made that result come out? Because that's quite important. And we have to keep those results in one place, but not forget what is actually done for the upfront setting. And I think anyone who looks at the SOLO-1 data is just, you know, mesmerized by in terms of the benefit. But right, these come up and we have to address that. And we have to know mechanistically why these results actually emanated. So it's a very important question. but it has not affected our practice in early stage. Okay.
Right. I would agree with you. And I think in countries where PARP inhibitors are not available up front, they are being used later line. So that's where the issues arise. Rebecca, do you want to comment on any of this?
You know, I think I don't really have too much more to add to what Sue very nicely described. I think, the fact that these trials are all a little bit different in the patients that they included and lumping together a lot of, variability in the prior pretreatments that these patients had makes it quite complicated. You know, I think a lot of them were so heavily pretreated, probably selecting for BRCA reversion mutations and, things that we wouldn't be so surprised that they wouldn't have a great effect with. But again, totally agree that it does not change my thought at all on the benefit of PARP inhibitors in the earlier line setting. And we have the luxury of being able to do that here, which is great.
Yeah, I agree. And I think by using PARP inhibitors up front, their first certain duration of time is a hard stop at either 2 years for a laparib or 3 years for niraparib. So that toxicity, the toxicity worries of leukemia or myelodysplastic syndrome are minimized as much as possible. So I think, as we've moved from later line to recurrence to now upfront, I think that's, you're getting the most potential impact on the cancer, but also minimizing toxicities as well. Rebecca, do you want to add anything to, from an immunotherapy standpoint? We're getting some questions in about the toxicities of immunotherapy, but how you think immunotherapy kind of, and expanding upon what Sue said, has impacted kind of where we stand for ovary and endometrial cancer right now.
Yeah, sure. So my work really is focused on trying to figure out ways to generate more effective responses to immunotherapy in GYN cancers. Immunotherapy, just sort of taking a step back. So immunotherapy is a form of therapy that really works to try to activate a patient's own immune system to target a cancer. Our immune system is there to recognize foreign things, but not just viruses and bacteria and foreign pathogens, but also abnormal cells like cancer cells. However, cancer cells are very smart and they are able to develop ways to hide from the immune system and then continue to grow. And so these immunotherapies basically try to reverse that process. The standard immunotherapy drugs are called immune checkpoint inhibitors, and they have been, they've really revolutionized the treatment of some tumor types. But unfortunately, as single agents, they've been studied extensively now in ovarian cancer, whether it's in the upfront setting or the recurrent setting or in the platinum sensitive or platinum resistant or in combination with chemotherapy. And no matter how many ways we look at it, they're just not effective yet in ovary cancer. And so my interest is really in trying to figure out novel ways to allow better anti-tumor responses with the goal of really improving or adding a whole nother area of treatment for these cancers that could have more effective and really durable responses. And so there's a couple areas that I think are exciting areas that I'm more focused on and that I think a lot of colleagues around the country are beginning to focus on in ovarian cancer. And I would say that one category is just combinations of immunotherapy. So not just single agent immune checkpoint inhibitors, but combining novel types of immune checkpoint inhibitors or immune checkpoint inhibitors with targeted therapies with antibody drug conjugates, like Dr. Campos mentioned, with vaccines, which we can talk more about, and then also cellular therapies. So cellular therapies are sort of a different type of immunotherapy that relies on taking immune cells. They can either be harvested from a patient or from a donor, or sometimes generated in the lab, and then modifying them outside of the body so that they can either express novel proteins to target a molecule on a cancer cell surface or just make that immune cell more potent in their activity or ability to kill a cancer cell, or just last longer in circulation, have a more memory-like phenotype. And that's one area of focus that I'm currently focusing on. We have a couple of trials that we are developing right now in ovarian cancer with different cellular therapies. One is a T-cell-based cellular therapy where we're engineering the T-cells to express different receptors that can more specifically recognize ovarian cancer cells and then be more effective at actually inducing a response against them. And another is kind of getting away from T cells in general and focusing on a different type of immune cell called a natural killer cell that has different characteristics that allow it to potentially be more active in the immunosuppressive microenvironment that we know ovarian cancers have. And combining those with these immune checkpoint inhibitors and novel other treatments to try to stimulate their response. I can maybe stop there in terms of ovarian cancer, and we can discuss any of that in more detail. In terms of uterine cancer, I think Dr. Campos already sort of highlighted that we do see some effective activity of immunotherapies in endometrial cancer, especially the ones that are known to be microsatellite instable or MSI high or mismatch repair deficient. We know that for those cancers, single agent immune checkpoint inhibitors are pretty effective. And now we have pembrolizumab and dostarlimab approved for those tumor types. But in the ones that are still microsatellite stable or MMR proficient, these agents alone still don't really cut it. And now we're lucky enough to have the combination of pembrolizumab with lenvatinib approved for microsatellite stable endometrial cancers. But beyond that, you know, thinking of other novel strategies, and one of the things that I'm working on is the combination of pembrolizumab with an antibody drug conjugate that Dr. Campos mentioned, mirvetuximab, targeting that folate receptor alpha protein that is overexpressed on some endometrial cancers and specifically in the serous population.
That's great. That's great. And Rick, I just, you know, I think it is striking in the most common type of ovarian cancer we see, which is called high-grade serous ovarian cancer, kind of the lack of responsiveness of the single agent checkpoint inhibitors. And any reasons to think why that's happening, whereas, you know, certain other cancers like lung cancer, melanoma, et cetera, and certainly microsatellite unstable endometrial cancer can see pretty significant response rates. Why ovarian cancer is just not responding to it?
Yeah, it's a really complicated question. I think that has a lot of answers. You know, there was a lot of early evidence that these cancers should respond to immunotherapy. It was actually one of the first tumor types more than a decade ago now to be where we saw that the presence of immune cells in these tumors, so the presence of T cells within the tumors, was correlated quite strongly to overall survival and clinical outcomes. So the tumors that had the immune cells present did better, suggesting that there must be an immune response in these tumors. However, even with the T cells present, when we give these agents, we're really not able to induce an effective response. And so that suggests that there are other factors in the microenvironment of these tumors and also within the host, you know, the cancer patients themselves, things that we might not yet quite understand, but genetic, you know, predispositions and genomic changes, even things like the gut microenvironment or, you know, other changes in immune cells, not so much the tumor cells, that can all factor into how the immune response plays out within the tumor microenvironment. It's not just the T cell and the cancer cell that need to come together and synergize, but there's a whole lot of other players in the immune microenvironment, other immune cells, the cells that line the blood vessels, neural cells, circulating factors that all really play a role. So, you know, we're really focusing on trying to understand those biomarkers of response or resistance better and trying to use that knowledge to then generate more rationally based combination therapies. But I think that it's still, you know, a work in progress and something that I hope, you know, I'll see a lot of improvement in as we're all working on this together.
Yeah, it sounds great.
And not all histologies, not all histologies may be the same. Like Ursula mentioned, like high grade serous, but you know, a different histology, like a clear cell, may be more amenable to immunotherapy than, for example, the high grade. So we're not bunching these all into one group, but really kind of dissecting them out and asking the question in each individual histological subtype.
Right, right. And we'll talk about genetics in a little bit, but you're absolutely correct, Sue. Good, really good point. So I was gonna ask you there were several questions on hormonal therapies for endometrial cancer, specifically for maintenance treatment after chemotherapy, as well as for treatment. And can you comment in which folks you'd think about using hormonal therapy instead of another treatment like chemotherapy or even pembrolizumab and lenvatinib. And hormonal therapy can also be used in ovarian cancer as well. And where do you use hormonal therapy there?
So that's a great question, you know, because oftentimes, you know, there's a thought process that an individual who might have advanced uterine cancer, and we're going to just give an example like pulmonary metastases, lung metastases, that you have to gravitate immediately to chemotherapy. But it depends. I mean, it depends on the histological subtype. You know, there are times where, you know, an individual might have an endometrioid histology that is strongly estrogen receptor positive. And these are individuals that you really can employ hormonal manipulation. For example, you know, some of the old drugs, actually, tamoxifen and megase, sometimes the aromatase inhibitors. We borrow a lot of these from breast cancer. There's combinations looking at what we call everolimus, which is a certain pathway in endometrioid histology. So you really can manipulate a uterine cancer sometimes, depending on the histology, with hormonal manipulation. And individuals can do very well for a very long time with hormonal manipulation and not have to cross that bridge to chemotherapy. Now, you know, there are other cases. For example, if there are other histologies like uterine pap serous or a carcinosarcoma or a clear cell, these are a different group of uterine cancers. And so that's when we tend to use more chemotherapy. But there is certainly a place in terms of hormonal manipulation, even in individuals with, you know, what we consider an advanced uterine cancer. You can manipulate that cancer very well with hormonal manipulation and circumvent chemotherapy for some time.
Yeah.
I was going to
ask you a follow-up question about the trial that's ongoing here that's looking at CDK4/6 inhibitors and how you think those are going, you know, combined with an aromatase inhibitor.
Absolutely.
Are you excited about that? Not excited about that?
Super excited. No, I'll tell you very honestly, in the endometrioid histology and uterine cancer, we borrowed a lot from breast cancer. It's a hormonally driven cancer. And some of you may know that there's been a tremendous amount of work done with CDK4/6 inhibitors, plus a hormonal manipulation, could be letrozole, faslodex. It really has shown amazing activity in metastatic breast cancer. So, you know, there have been several trials looking at combinations of these CDK4/6 inhibitors in combination with hormonal therapy. Our colleagues, Dr. Constantinopoulos, he has a trial that is looking at a drug called abemaciclib plus letrozole, and he's recently added a little metformin to the equation. And I'm incredibly excited about this because this is, again, another way to manipulate a cancer without having to utilize chemotherapy. It is a targeted chemotherapy. We talk about all these targeted therapies, but hormonal manipulation is a targeted therapy. So.
Yeah. No, agreed. And I think maybe, you know, as I'm thinking as we're chatting here, just to make sure that everyone understands in terms of how we think about endometrial cancer now. I mean, I think that you know, we used to have chemotherapy, but the genetics of the cancer plus the histology of the cancer, so what the pathologist says under the microscope, has really helped shape how we think about treatment. Rebecca, do you want to say a couple of words about sort of how we think about the uterine cancer specifically?
Sure. Yeah, I think we have learned a lot more specifically about the genomic changes in uterine cancer. So, you know, we still have the histologic subtypes that the pathologist reports from looking at the cancer cells under the microscope, whether, you know, the most common type being the endometrioid histology. There are more, you know, hormonally driven, a little bit more indolent. We also know there are more rare subtypes, the serous subtype or carcinosarcomas. And instead of, you know, it used to be that they were all treated the same. And I think to some degree, they start the same still, although I think we've made some changes there as well. But now that we have more molecular data looking at the actual DNA changes of the tumor cells themselves, we understand that, you know, within those histologies, there's actually four different main subtypes of molecular types of uterine cancers, and that they have different types of mutations that characterize them. And really, those mutations can drive the biology. And so it makes a lot less sense to be treating them all the same when they have very different ways that they are surviving and living in our body. And so It's now becoming much more common to do molecular profiling of these tumors to understand which molecular subtype they fit in. And we have some at least retrospective data now, looking back at how these different molecular subtypes do with different types of therapies. And then moving that into prospective testing with, you know, patients being put on clinical trials based on not just their histology, but then their molecular profile, and then choosing therapies based on that. So I think it really has opened up a whole new way to look at these cancers and to more, you know, rationally pick, as Dr. Campos was mentioning, there's a lot of different, you know, options between chemotherapies, hormonal therapies, targeted therapies, now, you know, immunotherapies, HER2 targeting therapies, and how do we think about which one of those would be most appropriate for each patient, and then what sequence to use those in, I think, is becoming a lot more clear as we understand the molecular biology and the genetics more.
That is a great segue into like a whole nother topic, which I think is a great time to start now. And it's really about the genetics of the cancer and how that impacts treatment, but also very simply, what do each of us do in terms of the different tests that we order from a genetic standpoint? So I want you both to answer these questions because there may be some practice differences as well. So Sue, what for somebody who's newly diagnosed with either ovarian cancer or endometrial cancer, what's your practice around genetic testing in terms of germline genetic testing, somatic testing, and then HRD testing?
Sure. So in terms of like ovarian cancer, all our patients, absolutely all of them, regardless of ethnicity, regardless of age, regardless of what you perceive to be a family history, all of them undergo germline testing. So the question is there a component that they inherited from their families that could have contributed, or could they have inherited a gene that contributed to their ovarian cancer? And that's a yes or a no. We get that answer very, very soon thereafter. That's exceptionally important on so many different levels. It's important because, you know, if they inherited a gene from a family member, father or mother, okay, then they have, you know, we have the obligation of counseling them in terms of what this could mean to their siblings, what they could this mean to their offspring. This is exceptionally important. Now, there are times where, and many times actually, when a patient is diagnosed with ovarian cancer, but there is no family history and the germline is negative. So then we look, well, if they didn't inherit the gene, could the gene have mutated in the tumor that actually caused this to almost be a mirror image of the germline situation? And that's called a somatic mutation. And sometimes that does exist in about 6 to 7% of cases. So for example, we test patients for if they inherited it from their family, a germline mutation. If that comes back negative, then we reflex to testing patients for somatic mutation. And also in some cases, I know that we have our own internal conversations about this, okay? You know, some of us actually will send off a test looking to see if the tumor has what we call HRD deficient or not. Now, why is that important? You know what I mean? That is important in a sense because it helps me have a dialogue with the patient in terms of when I do prescribe or suggest a PARP inhibitor, I'd like to know the magnitude of benefit. And although a lovely like 45 minutes to an hour doesn't encompass all of this, there's been several trials that have shown, you know, that that patients that are HRD positive but do not carry a BRCA mutation can still benefit very nicely from a PARP inhibitor, you know? So to me, you know, I get the test simply because I'd like to be able to tell the patient, you know, let me show you what the magnitude of benefit is. Now, it's important to note that the FDA approved these PARP inhibitors as part of some clinical trials, the PRIMA trial and the Paola trial, you know, irrespective if you test or not. So there are some individuals who feel they need not test because they're gonna give the PARP to everyone. And I value their opinion. Mine is what I just told you what it was. There are internal discussions about this.
Right. So it sounds like, Sue, you order everything. You get a germline test, which of course is standard of care around the world. And then somatic testing as well as HRD testing.
Correct. Yeah. That's a long way to do too. Sorry.
Yeah. And Rebecca, what's your practice?
So I totally agree. Everybody gets germline testing. You know, it's the absolute standard up front. I typically, in my practice, end up ordering both germline and somatic testing kind of concurrently up front. I do like to know sort of the details of the molecular changes in the tumor as well, because the way I think about it, most of these women, unfortunately, will have recurrent disease at some point, and we have a lot of treatment options down the road. And so I like to have that information sort of from the outset so that I'm prepared and thinking about future treatment decisions, even though, you know, it wouldn't affect the first line therapy. But totally agree with knowing the germline genetics, and then if negative, knowing the, you know, the mutational status of the BRCA1 and BRCA2 and other homologous recombination or DNA damage repair pathway mutations to make the first decision about PARP inhibitor maintenance therapy. And then my added piece that I typically do is get the full somatic mutation testing upfront as well. In terms of HRD testing, I typically have a conversation with my patients about that. So if there's a BRCA mutation, then of course, I highly recommend a PARP inhibitor unless there's some major contraindication. As Dr. Campos mentioned, we know that in patients that don't have a BRCA mutation but are HRD positive, and then even in some patients that don't have a BRCA mutation and are HRD proficient, we know that there still can be some, you know, albeit less robust, but some benefit from PARP inhibitor maintenance. So I typically have a conversation with my patients about what their, you know, thoughts and preferences around that are. If there's somebody that says, I want to do everything I possibly can do to decrease my chance of having a recurrence for as long as possible, then I don't necessarily send HRD testing, because it seems like even if negative, there's a possibility that, you know, they could still have some benefit and they may choose to do that anyway. If they're a patient that's a little bit more on the fence, I'll often send it, and then we have a discussion in light of those results.
Sounds good. And then for folks who have endometrial cancer, when do you order germline testing, and then when do you order somatic testing? Sue, I'll start with you first.
Sure. You know, so in all of our cases of uterine cancer, our pathologist provides us with the following information. There's a deficiency in these certain proteins that help repair DNA, MMR proteins. And if there are any aberrations in that, we do sometimes an additional test to see whether or not that is a sporadic event. It just happened by chance, or something called hypermethylation, or if in essence, you know, there are some abnormalities or abnormal findings in that initial screen, the DMMR, we send these patients to genetic counseling in the presence or absence of, you know, a strong family history. So the MMR is kind of, in many ways, very beneficial, because it's a kind of a poor man's test to really highlight who could potentially, you know, have a syndrome called Lynch syndrome, which can predispose patients to multiple malignancies, colorectal, endometrial, dermatological malignancy, and so forth. So automatically we get DMMR. If there's any abnormality, they get sent off testing for sporadic. And if there are any abnormalities that suggest that this is not a sporadic event, these patients will see genetic counseling to establish either yes or no, whether they have the potential for Lynch syndrome.
That's good. And Rebecca, your practice around testing in women with endometrial cancer?
I agree with what Dr. Campbell said. I think if any abnormalities in MMR testing or a strong family history or something that, you know, sounds suspicious, I would recommend sending them to a genetic counselor. But otherwise, it's not like for ovary where everybody gets referred for a genetic counselor.
Gotcha. And somatic testing, when would you send?
So I typically send somatic testing for any advanced stage disease, thinking again about future lines of therapy. I don't know that that's necessarily standard practice among all of us in our group, but.
Yeah, I tend to, I don't know what Sue is going to say, but I tend to, like, I think if it's going to impact treatment for somebody who's, even if they have an early stage cancer, I think we're not quite there yet, but we're moving towards de-escalation on pole E hypermutated cancers. But certainly if I think someone's higher risk or certainly has disease that's more advanced, I will definitely get it on everybody. Sue, any comments on that?
No, I mean, I do the exact same thing in many ways. You know, somatic testing is I mean, it's nice. And I think if the patient really wants to have that done, next generation sequencing, that is fine. But oftentimes that's something I usually get a little later on in that particular case. You know, it's good sometimes to get it through a fresh biopsy, you know, if the patient has unfortunately recurred.
Gotcha. All right, we're at 6:08. I want to finish up around 6:15 or 6:20. So a few more questions. This is a big one, Sue. But really, you've been instrumental in our group and been involved in a number of cervical cancer trials. And the landscape for our patients who've been diagnosed with cervical cancer has really changed quite dramatically over the past year. Can you comment on some of those changes and also some of the newer therapies that have entered into clinical practice?
Sure. It has been a tremendously exciting time. And, you know, Ursula and I, well, I can say I'm old, okay? You know, and we've been around for a little while and we've seen when we've had very little to offer. And then just to go into the literature for the last 2 years and just see how much has expanded in the world of cervical cancer. There was a study, it was a very monumental study called KEYNOTE-826, published in New England Journal of Medicine, whose trial was very exquisitely designed. It asked a very important question, and that was whether or not adding immunotherapy to the backbone of good old-fashioned chemotherapy, whether you could improve progression-free survival and overall survival. And this, without any question, the combination of these four drugs did improve progression-free survival and overall survival. That is for recurrent, persistent, or metastatic cervical cancer. So that has changed dramatically. It is specific to a group of individuals that whose tumor is PD-L1 positive. So we're also starting to check PD-L1 positivity in these patients because we know we have an additional regimen to give to individuals. If individuals did not receive this regimen because it's relatively new, it was just published in November of this past year, you know, if the tumor is PD-L1 positive, pembrolizumab is an option for these individuals in the recurrent setting. And more recently, you know, there's been an approval of a very different drug, actually. It's a drug called tisotumab vedotin, and it takes a little while to actually pronounce, okay? And it's an interesting drug because, once again, it's an antibody drug conjugate. And it's an antibody drug conjugate to something that was surprising to me, something called tissue factor. Interestingly enough, cervical cancers express a high degree of tissue factor. And there was an earlier study, something called the INNOVA study 204, which was a simple phase 2 study, which actually showed about a 24% objective response rate. And this has now been approved by the FDA, and we have that drug as a second line agent for cervical cancer. And, you know, the investigators have also expanded on that. They've started to look at tisotumab plus pembrolizumab in first line and second line. So there are many exciting arenas coming in the world of cervical cancer. It's certainly not sleepy at this point in time, not at all.
Yeah, no, thank you. Thank you so much for that. I'm gonna move to a question and then go back to some of so there are some questions that are coming in. I don't know if you guys can see them, but Rebecca, I'm gonna ask you this question. It says we can refer to ovarian cancer as a chronic disease. That sort of implies that it can be treated long-term. What's the cap you're seeing on, quote, long-term? And I think that's an open-ended question. And I think it speaks to the advances and in our patients. So I don't know if you want to comment on that one.
Sure. I think it's a great question. And it's a comment that I actually talk a lot with my patients about. And I think I use that kind of terminology of it can be thought about almost as a chronic disease where, you know, we do expect that over time, you know, whatever treatment regimen that the patient is on at the time, the cancer cells will become resistant and we'll have to think about something new. I think there's no real cap on, you know, what we're doing at this point that I can, you know, quantify. A lot of our clinical trials now, especially our cellular and immunotherapy trials, are specifically looking at patients who have had multiple lines of therapy, because we know that there are so many effective things that are now being, you know, approved in terms of what these patients can see. And so I think from my perspective, I don't really see a cap on it.
Gotcha. That's good. There's a question about a drug called relacorilant and nab-paclitaxel. That is a study that actually Jen Benares used to be in our group, worked on some of the preclinical aspects of this combination when she was at the University of Chicago. And that is the promising therapy. We know that binding of cortisol to the glucocorticoid receptor can reduce the efficacy of chemotherapies. And relacorilant basically is a drug that competes with cortisol at the glucocorticoid receptor. So you can potentially modulate the glucocorticoid receptor and make chemotherapy sort of work better in ovarian cancer. So this is a trial that we had going on here of three different groups. So it's relacorilant plus nab-paclitaxel. And the combination did show some efficacy. So now it's actually in a phase three clinical trial. So not quite ready for general use, but certainly promising enough to move to a phase three setting. And there've been a number of presentations about this trial. So I answered that question. Sue, I wanted to get to, there are a few questions that were submitted before today on, I'm getting my list of questions here, on quality of life. So that arise during treatment, such as cognitive changes, so thinking changes, as well as neuropathy, especially ototoxicity and tinnitus. Can you talk about how you address these issues in your practice?
Sure. I mean, it first starts by really asking the patient to report what they actually feel, you know, because that's extremely important, you know. And in terms of just a couple of them, neuropathy is probably the one that we interface with the most. And the truth to be told is that some people are more prone to neuropathy and yet others are not. And there's also, it's very important that some people develop neuropathy after they finish their chemotherapy. This is this concept called it's the coasting effect, it's called the neuropathy after the completion of chemotherapy. But what we often do is just ask patients, you know, simple questions, you know, can you button your shirt? Can you put your earrings on? Because that takes fine motor control. When you're at home, do you have, you know, how is your balance? Have you dropped anything? Can you feel the floor that you're walking on if you're walking barefoot? If there's any indication that there could be neuropathy happening, then there are a couple of things that we can do. We can certainly lower the dose of the chemotherapy to help mitigate that side effect. We can add certain drugs to actually, try to lessen the side effects. And if there's a real concern, then the patient often is seen by neurology at that point in time. You know, but often the thing that we normally do is we will lower the dose of the drug to help mitigate some of that side effects and provide some medication. And that medication can be, you know, a little bit of everything. It could be vitamin B complexes. Sometimes for some people, it can be drugs called like Neurontin. It could be acupuncture, which has been quite instrumental in some individuals. So it could be a whole varied issue. But you also have to think of why neuropathy exists. Is it really simply chemotherapy? Could there be an underlying cause in different areas? So that's neuropathy. Ototoxicity, we don't see that much of it, although, you know, when you sign a consent form, it is clearly that the platinums can cause ototoxicity and cause tinnitus. These individuals are seen by our ear, nose, and throat individuals. And these are individuals, if there's any kind of thought that they had this going into the chemotherapy, they probably should have an initial evaluation and get an audiogram so that we can gauge, you know, what chemotherapy is actually doing. So it is very, very important. But it really comes, and I can't emphasize this enough, by having the patient really speak to us in terms of this is what I'm experiencing, this is how bad it is, and not downplaying it, you know, it really so that we have the opportunity to address it head on.
And then cognitive changes?
So cognitive changes is very important because oftentimes cognitive changes can be the result of multiple factors, you know. The diagnosis is stressful, clearly. You know, the chemotherapy is stressful, clearly. Home situations are clearly. So you have to dissect out, are the cognitive changes, you know, based on some, you know, stress level, or is it based on what the chemotherapy may be doing at the same time? And we work very closely, you know, with our social workers, our psychiatry individuals, you know, just to try to understand if there's truly cognitive issues. Or at what degree, because they can occur. They usually are the result of multiple factors. And I think it's actually quite important to highlight that. In very rare cases, there are other more medical reasons for that. And we look for those also. But I think for most people, we start off with what are the factors that could be contributing to that? It's usually not just one answer.
Yeah, totally agree. All right, I'm gonna wind down with two questions. One question is gonna be a little longer, but, and then Sue, I'm gonna finish off with the last question with you. So Rebecca, we did get quite a number of questions around rare types of GYN cancers, which again, we could spend a long time on, but, and so, you know, questions around clear cell ovarian cancer, which I think both you and Sue have alluded to low-grade serous ovarian cancer and then carcinosarcomas of the uterus and ovary. Can you talk about the challenges of the rare tumors, but also the progress that's been made?
Yeah, sure. So I think, you know, as we learn more, we understand more, and that's great, but we also, it brings about other questions. And so realizing that these different types of rare tumor types are really not the same as high-grade serous ovarian cancer, and we need different strategies to treat them. I think the main challenge is that they are so rare. And so putting together large clinical trials where we can really, you know, test in a very robust way different types of therapies is very challenging. We have learned a fair bit about the molecular changes of each of these different subtypes that has allowed us to think more about tailored clinical trials and tailored targeted therapies. So for example, we already talked a little bit about clear cell in terms of, you know, there can be a higher rate of mismatch repair deficiency or microsatellite instability, and these tumors can respond more to immunotherapy. There have been some studies too looking at other specific molecular alterations that within the clear cell subset can predict response to IO therapy and duration of response. And so I think that we're making progress there in terms of biomarkers that could help us choose those patients. We also know that those clear cell tumors have high rates of mutations in proteins called ARID1A or PIK3CA. These are proteins that we do have targeted therapies for. And so, for example, we have a clinical trial in our phase one group right now with an EZH2 inhibitor, which is a targeted therapy for ARID1A mutated cancers. And so that's an option now for ovarian clear cell carcinoma patients. We also have a trial with a combination of pembrolizumab and lenvatinib, which we talked about in uterine cancers specifically for the clear cell ovarian cancer population. So I think now we do have options, and that's really encouraging to see. Low-grade serous ovarian cancers are sort of very different in their biology compared to clear cell. But the similarity is that they're also less responsive to chemotherapy than high-grade serous are. They are characterized by higher expression of the hormone receptors, so estrogen and progesterone receptors. And they also have a lot of mutations in the MAP kinase pathway. And so knowing those two things allows us to try to think about strategies involving hormonal therapies for these patients. And in particular, one big question that we have in the field is whether patients with low-grade serous ovarian cancers should even have chemotherapy upfront, or whether they should just have hormonal therapy. And so there's a large clinical trial, that NRG GY019 trial, which is randomizing women with stage 2 to 4 low-grade serous ovarian carcinomas with upfront therapy that's either chemotherapy followed by hormonal maintenance or just hormonal therapy alone, to try to answer that question. We also have clinical trials that are ongoing with drugs that target specific proteins in the MAP kinase pathway, either as single agents or combinations. And so, again, I think there's a lot more options that we can offer our patients with low-grade serous ovarian cancers than we previously had. I do think that carcinosarcoma patient tumors are the most challenging still to date in terms of really understanding the biology, because they tend to be more of a de-differentiated form of a high-grade serous ovarian cancer and not so much their own sort of biology. But I would say that the progress there is that we know now that a lot of those tumors do have overexpression of HER2. And so we're implementing HER2 targeted therapies into that population of patients. And also some of them in some analyses looking at the microenvironment of those tumors do suggest that they could potentially be more responsive to immunotherapies as well. So generating some immunotherapy-based trials for carcinosarcoma patients. But I think, you know, going back to the challenge, I think one of the things that is moving things forward now is that the formulation of what we call basket trials, which is, you know, taking a whole different, you know, population of patients, not just low-grade serous or not just clear cell, but you know, all rare subtypes together, and then putting them on one study that then allocates them to separate arms that have molecular-based therapies, you know, that correspond to their subtype of their diagnosis. And so, for example, there's a basket trial called the Bouquet study going on right now, which is all rare ovarian cancer subtypes. And then based on their specific subtype, they are assigned to a particular arm of the trial that chooses targeted therapies based on what's known about that disease. And so I'm hopeful that that will allow even more progress in the coming years.
Yeah, that's great. I mean, there's a lot going on. I think, you know, even within our group, we have a new trial open specifically for granulosa cell tumors of the ovary, clear cell cancers of the ovary, and then different trials that are based upon the molecular changes or genetics of each individual cancer, RAS mutations, et cetera. ARID1A, you mentioned that before, Rebecca. So I agree. Thank you for that great answer. Sue, I'm gonna finish with you. And this is one of the questions that came in from the live questions. I think it's a really important one. And it's for folks who are newly diagnosed with an ovarian cancer or on a PARP inhibitor. And the question is, can you and should you continue olaparib after 2 years?
Which is a great question. We get that every single day. You know, the SOLO trial studied olaparib for 2 years. And I will tell you very honestly, there was no magic about 2 years. You have to put a line in the sand. The PRIMA trial, which uses a different PARP inhibitor, and the olaparib did it for 3 years. So why two, why three? It makes no sense. I totally get it. But the way that the way the study was done with the with at least olaparib in the BRCA mutation, it was in essence 2 years. And you know, I think it's a valid question whether or not 2+ years would be could that be more beneficial? But perhaps it's not needed. I know. And if we look at the data that was just actually portrayed at the ESMO in France, the SOLO 1 data, you know, even after 7 years, okay, that was an overall survival. So it is conceivable that you need not more than 2 years of OLAP. But I think that's an important thing to remember also. And you're always balancing the efficacy that you hope to get with the drug, but also trying to mitigate the potential toxicity. So I think that's quite important. I think the SOLO 1 perhaps answered that a little bit. Like, it's pretty profound how well women with that had BRCA mutations did with olaparib even 7 years out.
So. Yeah, no, it's remarkable results. Any last comments, Rebecca and Sue? I know there was a lot of, I've got a lot of comments and about, you know, hope and progress that we're making. Any last comments, Rebecca?
I guess I would just say, as a more junior faculty member, I think it's a super exciting time to be in, you know, focusing on GYN cancers. I think there was a little bit of a lag in the field kind of before the last several years, and now we're just learning so much. And I think I'm really hopeful as well.
Yeah, sounds good. Sue?
I mean, exactly. I mean, Ursula and I have been here for some time, and we've seen when we didn't have these drugs to give to individuals,
yeah.
And now we do. And, you know, you always think back, oh my God, I know that individual. I wish I had that drug to give. But I will share with you, on Friday afternoon, I saw a patient I met 20 years ago, and, you know, she's still in my clinic, and, you know, she's a BRCA mutation carrier. You know, so I will share and leave that with you. It's been 20 years.
Yeah, it's pretty remarkable.
That's,
I agree.
That's amazing.
I know. Thank you guys so much. I want to thank the audience. We had at least one thank you from an audience member, and thank you. Really appreciate people joining in, and we got, you know, close to 90. No, we had about high of 95 people. So thank you so much, Rebecca and Sue. Thank you guys so much for being here this evening and for all the work you do and all the great care you provide. So everyone, have a great evening. Take care.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Take care. Thank you.